Britain's death toll linked to the novel coronavirus has risen to 29,427, overtaking Italy in recording Europe's highest total. According to the government, the total includes only deaths reported through the health ministry following tests in hospitals and care homes, with many experts estimating that at least 40,000 people have died following infections with the virus. An official report on Monday in Italy showed the country has recorded 29,315 deaths. Britain ranks fourth in the world for COVID-19 deaths per capita behind Belgium, Spain and Italy. Foreign Secretary Dominic Raab told reporters that Britain's death toll from the pandemic was a massive tragedy, adding that something on the scale of the country in this way had never been seen before. And now Dr. Chioma Maduka, emergency physician, joins us from London. Good morning, Dr. Maduka.
Hi, good morning.
How are you doing today with this kind of news?
Well, we'll still thank God for life. I'm great. Thank you for asking. We're still fighting the fight.
Keep up the good work. Now, UK's official death toll tops 32,000, overtaking Spain and Italy as the hardest hit country from COVID-19. Is there something missing in UK's response, perhaps?
What I can point out is UK came late to the party. By saying that, I mean the values or the measures of quarantine that was set in was started quite late. That includes all the social distancing, the lockdown measures, inclusive of the use of PPE, whereby policies were changing day to day. At first, it was said, okay, don't use the face masks, maybe you're not at risk. And then at first, we were not sure if the virus could survive in some certain climate. So all these things were things that came hand in hand and made the response to be not as sharp as it should have been. And frankly, by the time we started responding, so many people had already come into the country from all the infected places. So there were no measures at the airports, at the seaports, things like that, to try to curb the entrance of the pandemic into the country. So by the time everything started in full earnest, the damage had been done. I think that's what we would likely say could be a contributory factor.
Right. Now, what's your response to the fears that Britain could emerge as the worst hit country in Europe, despite being hit later than other countries?
Well, at the moment, the news already tells us that we are topping the charts in Europe. So at this point, the best thing is to respond to the situation we already find ourselves in. So it's no longer a case of trying to know if we're not going to keep recording more deaths, more than other European countries, because at the point, yeah, we are topping the charts. Mm. So it's just, we have to just respond as we see the numbers and keep doing as much as we can do, include a lot of PPEs to our work, continue the social distancing, continue alerting people in trying to take measures to make sure that they stay safe. So right. We're already there. So we just have to keep crossing the bridge.
Right. We hear of a certain coronavirus contact tracing app. Tell us more about it.
Oh, okay. It's called a contact tracing app. It's an app that was developed by the Technology and Research Department of the NHS in conjunction with Oxford University and some tech companies. So what it's basically doing is, just like it suggests, contact tracing, trying to make sure that we're able to know who is susceptible to getting this virus or who could have come in contact with somebody. These are measures that they're trying to put in place because there is a hope that the lockdown measures will be eased. And then there is a fear that if this is eased, there would be a second wave that might be worse than what we've already seen. So the app is quite a simple one. It's available on Google Play or the iPhone App Store, whereby people download the app into their phones. Then while the app is in their phone, you just key in your postcode. We have postcodes everywhere. Your house has a postcode. And just what it just needs is the first half of the postcode. Then the app works with the phone's Bluetooth, whereby it works in the background. Anyone you come in contact with, it does some kind of pinging to try to know the distance you are standing away from that person. So like maybe 2 meters or less than that, and for how long you stood with that person, it just keeps storing that information. Then in subsequently, if perhaps the person who owns that phone starts having some symptoms, all you need to do, key in into the app what the symptoms were, like cough, lack of sense of smell, no taste, or sore throat, things like that, then the artificial intelligence of the app would try to now stay with these symptoms that you've stated. Is it possible that the person could be COVID-19, coronavirus positive and having a COVID-19 disease? And if it says that that's a high possibility, the app sends you a message to self-isolate for 14 days. And then at the same time, it would now go back to the information that it had collected all the time, all the people that you've come in contact with. And if there is anyone that maybe is deemed to be high risk to have come in contact with you, it sends a message to that person's phone, assuming the person also has the app, of course, and then tells the person to also self-isolate. But the good part is that it wouldn't say it's you. So it's not like it's like telling all your story to the world. And then the app will go further to tell you where to go for testing. And then if the test comes out positive, you continue the self-isolation. If it's negative, it tells you to stop self-isolation, that you are free and clear. And also sends to those other people who it has told to start self-isolation, isolating, to stop as well, that they are now free and clear. So I think it's quite a brilliant one that has come up. And the UK has started testing it in the Isle of Wight, I think yesterday. And they said once it's tested and well received and has a good success rate in the next 2 weeks, the whole of England and UK at large would start using it.
One more question, Dr. Maduka, is how about the issues, privacy concerns? You know, how is the government responding to that regarding the app?
Well, in a statement I read by the chairman of the NHS, he was confident that the app was protecting people's data and privacy very well. What was stated was that the information that the app collects, it's only stored for about 28 days. And then after that, it's wiped off and the new data is collected. Information of people is not given out to others. For example, the one I said, that when someone is positive, it sends out messages to someone who's been in contact, but it doesn't mention the name. And also to note, this is not the first country that has had this kind of app. Singapore had something like that. I think it was called Contacts Connection, something like that. And they've been running it, I think, since February or March. And as at March, they had more than 800,000 people download the app. So if more than 800,000 people have downloaded this kind of app and have not had any complaints about privacy settings, then I believe that this shouldn't really be bad. And well, let's face it, the pandemic is real. People are dying. So I should think someone would be more concerned about being alive and also taking the assurance that your privacy is well in place than just being obstinate about, I don't want to use it because my privacy is being impinged. So I think it's still well within the rights of people.
Absolutely correct. Thank you so very much, Dr. Chioma Maduka, and do keep safe where you are.
Thank you for having me. All right. Have a blessed day.